1, 2. Come with me to Paradise Row. Cela ngikubulela i-track ke. I'll carry your love. This you must believe. Take my hand down Paradise Road, away from heartache, without any.
Dimacheroni. Goeiemôre. Good morning. And those who are from the townships, we say, Itara. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Ayanda Ali. I have the privilege and the honor today of being your program director. Because this is such a close-knit family, you'll be looking and wondering, I am a communicator, a community development practitioner, a creative. When this fateful day occurred many years ago, I was a journalist and a reporter. I have since grown, worked for the state, come back into the community space, and I find myself here with you today. And I can say without a shadow of doubt that this is one of the greatest honors I have been given. Ngiyabonga, ngiyajabula ukuba nani namhlanje, ngidumetse haholo, thata thata thata. During my time, thank you so much, TP. During my time as a media professional, when I saw the image that the rest of the world saw that shook our country to the core, the bloodshed that we had never experienced since the dawn of our democracy, I was moved to put pen to paper when I saw your tears, Bomama, when I heard the cries of Abantwana. I thought to myself, I must write about it. I wrote a song about it, and with your permission, I would like to share it with you today. We, the workers, we built this country. Our efforts, they keep it running. But our children, they are starving. No resources. No money. Eye Marikana Oam. Eye Marikana Oam. Eye Marikana Oam. The workers, we leave our families, we go beneath the surface, and sometimes without returning, but we cannot afford to buy what we are mining. Our life is as dark as the shaft in the belly of the earth, the belly of the earth, Marikana Oam. Eye Marikana Oam. Eye Marikana Oam. We have the freedom, but where is the money? We need deliverance from all this poverty. Africa's sons and daughters arise from obscurity. Yeah, 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 yeah. Aluta. Continua. Eie Marikana Oam. Eye Margana Om Om Mama Eye Margana Om Om Mama Margana Om Om Margana Om
Siyabonga. And that, ladies and gentlemen, was my small offering to those who lost their lives. As we gather today, I am here among people who have offered much more than I have. I would like to acknowledge them now, the leadership of AMCU here present, and the various structures represented, including the region, the branches, the shafts. Siyabonga kakhulu, siyan acknowledge. We know that it is August, nyanga yabo mama, and those who have paid the highest price for the ordeal that we've been through as a country, nini bo mama, siyanamkela, both the women in mining and the families represented here today. Dignitaries in our midst, please, please, we notice you, we welcome you, we thank you for your time. We would like to also acknowledge Sibanye Stillwaters, various other valued stakeholders in our midst, including the contractors. Last but certainly not least, every single one of us gathered in one accord here today, consider yourself welcome. Siyabonga kakhulu. I think regardless of which side of the spectrum you sit, one thing we can all agree upon is that what happened on that day and the days leading up to it was not to have happened. These are things that should not have been done. And regardless of your political affiliation, your religious persuasion, or even where you sit in terms of race relations, we are one when we say we need to introspect as a nation, learn from the past, remember what was, but not stop there. We need to do better for those who are here and now. And we need to do even more for the generations to come. So in this place are those who are saying, we want to do more going forward. We want to do better. Let us begin by receiving a short safety briefing as we are here today. I'm told that there will be a representative from the venue where we are at the moment who's going to deliver a short safety briefing. I'm going to ask for that gentleman or that lady to make themselves known, please. In the absence of that hand going up, I think we can continue with the proceedings. This is something that we can always return to as the official day unfolds. Masiqale ke ngomthandazo, because Tina, we know but we are not our own. We belong to a creator. And I have the privilege and the honor now of asking Bishop Paul Verein to just open for us in a brief word of prayer, and also give us words of wisdom. Bishop, may you come forward, please, sir.
Good morning, everyone. I'm going to read to you from Luke chapter 6. And I would ask you to keep at the back of your mind a passage in Matthew, which is called the Sermon on the Mount. And now this is how Luke writes about the same event. He went down with them and stood on a level place. A large crowd of his disciples was there, and a great number of people from all over Judea, from Jerusalem, and from the coast of Tyre and Sidon, who had come to hear him and be healed of their diseases. Those troubled by evil spirits were cured, and people all tried to touch him because power was coming from him and healing them all. Looking at his disciples, he said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, because great is your reward in heaven, for that is how their fathers treated the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have already received your comfort. Woe to you who are well fed now, for you will go hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all people speak well of you, for that is how their fathers treated the false prophets. I tell you who hear me, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who ill-treat you. The word of the Lord. Let me just briefly reflect on that. If you know Luke at all, you will know that he has a very strong emphasis on justice and the poor. And so he actually, just let me remind you, he said, St. Matthew says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. He says, blessed are the poor. And so I'd like to suggest to you that probably Luke was the first communist and understood how communities should operate. For me, it's also interesting that Luke does not differentiate between healing and teaching and empowerment. We're not, in actual fact, individuals who work in silos. So this is my academic bit. This is my material bit. This is my physical bit. They all are meant to integrate into congruence. My mind is meant to inform what my eyes see. Now we come to the memorial and the celebration of those. There's another part of scripture which says, greater love has no one than this, that they lay down their lives for their friends. And we come into this space to remember those who have laid down their lives. In the early 1960s, there was a terrible event that happened in this country. There were people who were basically shot in the back because they protested against the disaster of discrimination because of race. You'll remember that. Marikana heralded for me the new discrimination that we have to suffer with as a country. And that is the discrimination between the haves and the have-nots. It's a new apartheid. It goes way, way back in history. But let me just say to you, and let me now speak as a religious person. We are not going to get away with greed. We're not going to get away with corruption. And so as we remember these people, let us not remember them as we remember statues. Because they actually said no to inequality. They actually said no to the violence that there is in poverty. That's in actual fact what this day is about. And it heralds the beginning of the bigger struggle that we have in this country, the struggle for justice, the struggle for compassion in the face of unbridled greed. It's an uncomfortable message. It's an uncomfortable message when we're sitting in such a grand hotel, with due respect. You know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. But if you, in your journey, cannot see the poor anymore, let me warn you that you're losing your sanity. You're losing your humanity. And we come year by year by year to this place to remind ourselves that we dare not lose that insight. And the poor are not just a kind of piece of imagine. They are real people. There are more than 20 million people in South Africa who go to bed at night hungry. And then there are a huge number of people who have got so much food that they actually cannot stuff it down their mouths any longer. And so let's go from this place as people determined to work for justice. Let us not stop tirelessly trying to make sure that we empower our young people, of which there are 6 million who have not got jobs between the age of 18 and right into their 20s, and who can't find jobs, and who are not going to have a normal future, because we must understand that those are the seeds that we are planting in the future of this country, and we will pay for it. Let me speak quickly to religious people. If you go to church every Sunday and you enjoy the pantomime that takes place in terms of the singing and the music and the preaching and the reading of the word, it remains a pantomime as long as it stays imprisoned in that building where you are worshiping. The real expression of our worship, as we get from this passage, is amongst the dispossessed. That's where the secret is to the future of the prosperity of this nation and of this conflict and of this continent. May God bless us as we respect not just in our imagination, and not just with our words, the lives that have paid for a better future. Greater love has no one than this, that they lay down their lives for their friends. Let us pray. O God, we stand at the foot of your cross today. And at that cross we meet those who were killed on that field near the Kopi in Marikana. We keep silence as we remember them. But we pray as well today, O Lord, for the whole mining industry that gets given an opportunity through their social and labor plans to plow back into communities some of the profits that they make, hand over fist. And we pray, O Lord, for those communities where those social and labor plans make absolutely no difference whatsoever. And where there is an hypocrisy about the licenses that they are supposed to get because they have consulted communities, but haven't really. Because they haven't really got time in their busy agendas to be able to open a space to listen to the cries of the dispossessed. We think of those who go down holes to bring out gold and platinum and. We pray for the quality of their lives and the meanness that takes place in negotiations for improvement in wages. And we pray for those who negotiate and ask for the skill and the wisdom and the words that can shift the hardness of the hearts of the owners of wealth. We pray for something different in this country, Lord. We also pray for our relationships. We pray that we can see how stupid discrimination is at every level. Discrimination against women, discrimination against children, discrimination against another tribe, discrimination because of color, discrimination obviously because of those who have and those who have not. Speak to us deeply, so that we don't continue being a superficial smile that hides our deeper cynicism. We pray for those who continue to remember that dreadful day in August when someone they loved was no more. And we ask that in the loneliness and in the trauma that returns, you would accompany them as counselor, as friend, as healer, as teacher, as the one who promised that blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. We pray for ourselves. Scrutinize our motives and our integrity so that when we speak of you, what we say will be the truth. For we ask these things in your name and for your sake. Amen.
Thank you so very much. Could we please give a round of applause in recognition for the word from a man who I can testify and say he practices what he preaches, and indeed he walks the talk. And as you were sharing from the scriptures, Bishop, I thought to myself, this reminds me of a saying that says, the only thing that is required for evil to triumph is for good men and women to do nothing. In difficult times,
we remember not the words and the antagonism of our detractors. We remember the silence of our friends. And so when you see a man in a difficult time walking the talk and speaking truth to power, then you know that he's a great friend indeed. And I'm of the view that in my, you know, purview and in my midst are men and women who are fearless in the way that they walk the talk, and they're able to be true friends who are able to be vocal about the injustice that we see. But I get ahead of myself. We've not been officially welcomed, so let me not speak too much. Please allow me, ladies and gentlemen, to call upon the General Secretary, Udada Ujef Mpahlele, to officially welcome us here today.
Thank you, MC. Earlier on, we were just debating about this. Is it a term or a word, MC? Others are saying it's master of ceremonies. Others are saying, no, it's mistress of ceremonies. So I hope I will be happy to say MC. So you'll choose where you fit. Thank you very much, Comrade President Matunjwa, President of AMCO, Comrade Deputy President of AMCO, Comrade Putuma Manyati, Comrade Treasurer of AMCO, Comrade Jimmy Gama, in absentia, Comrade Manke from Education, and the Comrade Latsweng from Health and Safety Desk nationally, and all members of head office that are present here. From finance, we've got Esther. From also from health and safety, we've got Osi. You are also welcome. And to our regions, or the region that is represented here, predominantly it would be the region from Rustenburg, led by its chairperson, Comrade Tsega Jabuko, and all that surrounding you, the branches from the region, Omama, distinguished guest, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for having to attend to this morning with us here. We are very pleased to be able to welcome those of you that have been here for so long with us, referring to some of the guests behind myself, Bishop Varain, Larry Dave, and many others. And those who are joining us for the very first time, we want to extend our hearty welcome to this memorial lecture about Marikana. So we welcome you. Without you, we would not be able to achieve. I think we have heard from the scripture that if we miss in remembering what happened, we will be doomed for life. We are also joined by an old friend of mine, Obrima Jigwe, in our midst. We come a long way with him as well. So you are also welcome in this midst. So I welcome all of you, Krista. I nearly forgot you. We also have a gift who is here from head office. You're also welcome. And for those that I don't see them, remember that the age is not on my side anymore. You will pardon me. But we've got also Miss Lamini Mpepu. You are also welcome, Sisi. I think you are going to grace us with your lovely voice immediately after this. And thank you very much. Enjoy the event. Thank you.
Siyabonga kakhulu. Thank you very much. I'm sure now we are settled. We all feel embraced and we feel welcomed indeed. Ladies and gentlemen, an anthropologist called Margaret Mead once said, "Never doubt that a small group of individuals can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. And so we look forward to discussion and discourse that is thought-provoking, that will be impactful and empower all of us to do our bit to change the world. One woman who is changing the world with her vocal abilities, and I think her presence, because even her name says is Umunongu Kanya. She brings rays of sunlight, of brightness into our midst. And so may we please just give her a moment to give us musical interlude for us to digest what we have heard and to also look forward to the food for thought that we have yet to receive. So Unogu Kanya is going to give us two songs as she takes to the stage. Unogu Kanya Dlamini Mpepo. Ngicela simamkele ngezandla ezifudumele kakhulu. Thank you.
Pindukulu memoya oyincwele pindukulu me go siya. You can sing along if you know the song. Pindukulu memoya oyincwele pindukhulume kosiya ngoba so moya ho incwele pindukhulu menkosiya pindukhulu bethixo dimamele ngithi pindukhulu menkosiya pindukhulu methixo dimamele pindukhulu menkosi yam ngoma zonke izono zam zisobala smanga memoya oyincwela pindukhulume go goma 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 sonke izono zami namhla Nkosi yami sesoba kulume pindukhulume 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 kosiya ukhulumba kuluma kuluma nkosiya kuluma ndimamele kuluma
Kulum 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 kul
amen. Kuluma ba. Kuluma Jehova. Kuluma wena nsulu yemisakal. Tatana. 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 Kuluma. Kuluma ba. Kobaso kisono ebengizenza namhlanje sobala ebusweni bakho pintu khulu nemoya hoyi ngwele pintu khulu me kosiya Oba song sound guy September look at me say it fal ebu sweni bako pintu kulu le moya hoyi ngwele pintu kulu me kosiya You said two songs? Okay, I can play the next song. Hallelujah! I am so happy to see women here. Igama la makhosi. Sicela bomama. Malibo. Kugcwele imbokodo phela la. Oh, anilazi iculo lenu. Malibo. Malibongwe ma Malibongwe Asibambe ke ngoba ngeke nize niyeke Mayibonga imbokodo Eh Okay I'm coming back I need to sort out something please continue
Jacketi, we're now taking them off. The chalis are coming off. We're nice and warm now. We are ready. So thank you so much. Don't worry, Nokukhanya is with us for the rest of the proceedings. She will join us again in a moment or two, and she will be with us even as we close. So those of us who are saying her music, iyalapha, it is healing. Kore wetseking, gautla ke afola. Sisazo Paula even more. She'll be with us a little bit later. Ladies and gentlemen, before I call upon the official keynote speaker, I'm reflecting on the words of Dr. Martin Luther King, whose struggle many, many miles away is not different to the struggle that we faced during apartheid and that we continue to face in its evolution today. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. understood the urgency of now. I'm looking at the theme, and the theme says, rather be a prisoner of a dream than a slave of the past. And I thought to myself, it means most. This is urgent. It means change must happen, and it must happen now. It means we can no longer delay the inevitable. Yoguti, we must see difference where we are in our own sphere of influence. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. put it this way. He said, we are now confronted with the fact that tomorrow is today. We are faced with the fierce urgency of now. And in this unfolding conundrum of life and history, there is such a thing as being too late. Now is not the time for complacency. Now is the time for fierce and rigorous action. I don't know what that action looks like to you where you are. But I'm sure there's something that you can be a catalyst of in your area. It can be in the home. It can be in the workplace. It can be in the community. It can even be in chambers, because I'm about to call my Leonard friend. It can be in the highways or byways of life. And it can be in our justice system and in our judiciary. So someone who I know is a fire starter where he is.
is a catalyst for change where he is in his own corner, is the gentleman who's about to deliver now the keynote address. They call them my Leonard friend. Indeed, Advocate Muzi Sikakane, Senior Counsel. Sir, the floor is yours.
Well, I you quote Dr. Martin Luther King. It's very appropriate, because in one of his last sermons, he actually talks about something related to marijuana. May have been in 1960, but he says, if you've not discovered what you can die for, you're not fit to live. And it's a sermon he gives as if he could see that he was going to die. And so we are here to talk about people who had discovered. Should I swap? Thank you. People who discovered what to die for. And of course, they shouldn't have died. And they say, actually, people do not die. The only time they die is when we stop remembering them, and when we stop remembering what they died for. And I'm very happy today that Father Bishop Paul Verein is here, an old friend. And I also ask a friend of mine of close to 40 years, I'm about to disclose my age, Aubrey Machiqui. I called him because, and I'm happy that Father Verein is here, that what I'm going to talk about are four things. One is, where does this death of an African person comes from? Where does it come from? What causes it? And I'm going to emphasize that because it talks about, the two of them will know this better, what I call the colonial project and the castration, the spiritual castration of African people, and the subsequent deaths of African people since 1652 to now. But of course, I don't want us to keep remembering people who died as if they do not have names. They are a crowd that just disappeared. And I know this is a lecture, but I think it's important to call up their names before we talk about certain theories. And secondly, I'm going to talk about what really causes their death, and what causes the death that we experience today. Because we live with the violence that killed them. Because we live with poverty and we tolerate it. And you can only judge human beings by two things: what they do and what they tolerate watching being done. And so we're here because the following people died. It's Toby Lempumza. It's Tabile Telejane, it's Anele Mdizeni, thank you. It's Makosandile Mkonjwa, it's Julius Mangojwa, it's Genevieve Liau, it's Tabiso Masebetane, it's Mafolisi Mabia, it's Ntandazo Nogamba, it's Fezile Sapendu, it's Sitelega Kadlela, it's Henry Pato, it's Michael Ngweyi, it's Patrick Akona Chilase, it's Bonkosi Yona, it's Andres Msenyeno, it's Mzugisi Sompeta, it's Jackson Leura, it's Mpuzeni Ngande, it's Mpangeni Lekusa, it's Mongezeleli Tenecha, it's Tebisi Leyana, it's Mkuneni Noka, it's Kwawamare Elias Munesa, it's Bongani Ndongopele, it's John Lidingwane, it's Baba Alomchazi, it's Tembinkosi Kwelani, it's Nkosiyabo Kolabile, it's Bongani Mtse, it's Daleng Muhai, it's Mudiswatsile Sakhalala, it's Mulefi Ntswele, it's Hassan Fundi, it's Franz Matlomula Mabelane, it's Tapelo Eric Mabebe, it's Tembelake Madi, it's Hendrik Tietzi Muhene, it's Silo Roni Lipaka, it's Sandi Teise, it's Mlanduli Henry Saba and Pumzile Sokanyile. Thank you. I actually thought we should start But just saying, we gather here because a couple of you, if not all of you, and I'm happy that I have this opportunity because AMCU has not been recognized enough. And Baba Matunjo, what I want to recognize is this, is that the advent of what we call our democracy has come up with a couple of things. And one of them is the retreat of God. I told Bishop Vorain now that one of the first victims of post-colonial and democratic dispensations is God. The retreat of God, he's chased away from our space. The second is truth. The reason we don't, I brought my office here because I tend to make reckless statements. It's truth, it's my truth, but maybe they tell me don't go there. But I go there, and AMCU was the first, and the EFF as well, by the way. They were the first to tell the truth when it was not fashionable to tell the truth to our new state, because we all feared this state. We fear comrades that we worked with. We fear them because we want to keep our double-storied houses. We fear them because we want to keep our cars. We fear them because we don't want to die. And so AMCU was probably one of those first, well, the first union to show us that we have to face our new rulers right in the face and tell them the truths they don't want to hear. And for that, I think you... And we gather here when the liberation movement and many other formations that have pretended for so long to lead our people have failed to call to order those who took the political decisions to kill African people. And I say it's the decision to kill African people because it's old. And as I tell you about why I think we get killed and why we kill one another, and I'm going to talk about the question of race of the African body and why it is about lack of self-respect by our own leaders. I say this because the people who were at the helm at the time when these people died occupy high offices in our country. Yes, we've paid damages because we believe money can heal people, but it's not true. What we've not done and we've allowed to happen is that the political leadership that administered the killing of these African people remain at the helm and have never been called to account. And I'm going to talk about these three arms of government in this country that we fear, that we do not call to account. That's the judiciary, that's the legislature, and that's our executive, that continue to administer because they form this elite pact of people who've forgotten, who've grown a distance between them and the ordinary person. Ironically, this death and these lives of Africans are killed because they are cheap. And these lives die because we do not value African life. If 34 white people had died in this country, our leaders would not forget to remind us every day. They would create monuments in each and every street corner. They wouldn't have opened the speech at the Union Building yesterday without acknowledging them. Because ironically, we live because of what I call spiritual castration of the African person. We live our lives trying to please the very people that don't think we are human. And our leaders are at the helm of this consistent, persistent desire to please the people who don't like our race, who keep it down. And these are the truths we don't want to tell because we have now commercial interests in the new order. And it is for that reason that 34 people are killed simply because they are asking for 12,000 rand money most of us give to our children to go to university as money they must use to buy a phone, to buy airtime. And these people died asking for 12,000 rand. They were not even asking for what they should have asked for, which is that we must co-own the minerals of this country, that the land and minerals of this country must belong to the people who were found here, indigenous people. No, they didn't die for that. Worse still, we speak in high terms to please the people who own mines where our people died and got exploited every day. And as I say, we do this because what I call the original sin. And this sin starts with people who, 82 people, 82, it's a shame. We should be ashamed of ourselves as indigenous people that 82 people in 3 ships sailed on our shores in 1652, 80 of them. It was 72 men and 8 women in the dromedaries and the other 2 ships. They settled, and from that day on, our lives changed. So we gather to remember those people who, from time to time, since 1652, have died as a symbol of our suffering, as a symbol of our pain, and largely as a symbol of how we betray one another when we have power. And so those people are victims of what I call the original sin of our spiritually vacuous leaders. The leaders who've decided in this continent that even when they take political power, that political power is not used to uplift our ordinary people. Now, of course, yesterday I was listening to the president and it occurred to me that we are led by people who've simply forgotten what it was that we struggled to overturn. And as we speak about poverty, we do not realize that those who are poor, who live in dehumanizing poverty, live with violence every minute of their lives, because poverty is violent. You must ask those who live in it. And there are many people who pretend that they know violence, but poverty is violent. And I must acknowledge my other friend, Dali, who just walked in, because he walks that path that I was talking about, that it's the path of telling truth to those we fear. And he's been at the helm since the day one of Marikwana. And he gets called by all sorts of names. And it comes with the territory. Truth telling is a lonely path. Truth-telling is not a popularity contest. I'm not popular for making the speeches I make. No one is, and we don't want popularity. But it is our job to remind everyone that has forgotten that we must hold our leaders accountable for what they do. We must hold the traitors who drip in black, green, and gold, deceiving our people that they've led them, when they've done what I call a grand betrayal of our people. And we're scared to tell them because we do not want the consequences of truth telling. And I say to you that the worst form of oppression is the one in which you participate because you have no alternatives. And that is where we are in South Africa at the moment. And it is no longer credible for Africans who are in the majority to complain about white and colonial control. Yes, that's the original sin. When 80% of the population and their leaders and their liberation movements are controlled by less than 20% of the country. It's a shame. When a few people who control 80% of the economy to the exclusion of 80% of the population, that population must ask itself serious questions. And I don't want to talk about our leaders, because I think at that level we know what we're dealing with. We're dealing with people who've consciously decided to betray the rest of the population for their commercial interests. And so those people that we remember today are a symbol to me of what I called our sins, because we are spiritually vacuous people, but also because we do not mind betraying ourselves and our own, and we do not mind letting our own die. It's not new. It's a shameful act of betrayal of the African people who have never known peace, who've never known prosperity since they were born. All of you in this room, each one of you, whether you like it or not, have never known prosperity. And if we allow things to continue as they are, you'll never know it. Your children will never know it. Their children will never know it. So what really is wrong with us? What is it that makes us betray one another even when we have the so-called political power? What is it that when our leaders are released from jail in 1990 and 1992, they did not go to the grave of Robert Sobukwe? They did not go to Tsigi Biko, the wife of Steve Biko? They didn't go to the wife of Robert Mangaliso Sobukwe? They went to Fervoort's wife to hug and kiss her. I am not attacking Mandela for this. Mandela could do whatever he liked for being magnanimous. I'm saying this because it symbolizes our conduct towards our own. That Tsigi Biko and Mrs. Sobukwe were not the first to get a hug from our leaders who were from Robben Island, symbolizes our attitude towards blackness. So what exactly are we dealing with? What is it that was taken away from our spirit? And let me tell you what it is. The colonial project, yes, was about taking the wealth, the mineral resources of the country, and that you could get back if you grow enough courage, by the way. But what is it that makes us not grow sufficient courage to take back what is ours? It is because the colonial project took much more than money from a black person. It took away our humanity. So we can have as many judges as you like, you can have as many presidents as you like, and you can have many members of parliament as you like, and they can be as black as you like. One thing about each one of them is that they do not like blackness. They do not like themselves. And for everything they do, they seek white approval before they do it. They don't seek your approval. The reason they tell you about something called the balance of forces, in short terms, in simple terms, what our comrades call the balance of forces, is nothing but a justification for fearing a white minority in our country. That's the forces they are balancing. So, we gather. Mesuzulu sikubiza ukuzobhonga emswaneni. Laba bazisizulu bayazi ukuthi ngisho ukuthini. But two, last time I spoke about this, it was people in Phoenix who died yet again. Ngathi, lesisho sesizulu si deep, singifaka in trouble because people say I'm asking for revenge, which I am asking for. Sithi akukho zinyane lemvubu ladliwa zingwenya kwaxweba iziziba. Now, of course, people literally think I'm asking for people to go out and kill others and revenge. No, I'm asking each one of us to make sure that the suffering, the death, of people in Marikana, in Phoenix, in Kukuletu, in Nyanga, in Langa, in Sharpeville, and everywhere else where an African blood has been spilt must not happen in vain. You may be next. You definitely may be next. And this is not a question that only black people must do. It's something that all of those who recognize humanity and human emancipation must do. And that doesn't have to be black. The human spirit exists in each one of us. And these are truths that are about each South African, black, white, striped, and dotted. And so I'm happy that I'm here today, but I'm unhappy that we're celebrating, we're commemorating something that shouldn't have happened. The Marikana massacre, as I said, was a symptom of the attitude of South Africa's new leaders towards their own people, towards poor African people. It was a marker, a shining light to expose what slaves do to other slaves when they taste power and become nothing but an extension of the old, exploitative, white capitalist and murderous hand. It is an utter shame about which they show no remorse. We can spend, how many years is it now? 11 years, we've been asking one man to say sorry. And he hasn't. And when I say one man, I don't mean Cyril Ramaphosa only. I mean the entire cohort that administered the death of their own people. We're not asking for money. They can't say sorry. It's not because of pride, by the way. It's because the value of your life, because you are black, because you are African, is not recognized. I tell you now, the day two white South Africans die the way we have died, this country will change. I don't know whether for the better or the worst, but it will change. It tells you what we mean, not only to those who oppressed us, but what we mean to those we entrusted with our country to lead us. We mean the same to them that we meant to those who killed our people in Soweto or Sharpeville and everywhere else. They do this sometimes unconsciously, and sometimes in the name of sophistication, they ignore the cries of our people. They have imbibed as common sense the neoliberal logic and see it as something that must be done because it's universal. And it keeps our miners down underground working for something less than 12,000 rand, because if they went beyond that, the threat of concomitant action will come for them to die for demanding something most mine owners spend having a dinner or breakfast with a friend. They kill and poison each other these days. And you would think they fight because they differ about how best to live African lives. No, they fight about who must take the biggest crumb from the table of their master. They crave the recognition of the system that their people ask them to fight. We kill, we condemn, and despise ourselves. In our tragic and contradictory quest to seek freedom, whose basis is the permanent happiness of oppressive classes that we hate, we are a pathetic lot, if we must admit. We are a pathetic lot because we are a majority that should not accept one woman, one African woman, one African man to go to sleep to bed hungry. We shouldn't, if we valued our lives. And for that, I say we must seek to stop, if we can, our desire to seek validation from people who don't like our race, people who don't like other people, and create a South Africa between black and white and everybody else that value human life because it's human life, not because it's white. We shouldn't be here 30 years later. The Marikana massacre, therefore, is a symbol of our colonially learned attitude toward black lives. Our entire political settlement, I'm not being ungrateful when I critique this settlement, because we liked it. We were fooled to think it was something nice. We voted, we formed queues. But this entire settlement was designed to ensure the continued survival of white power and to expand the tentacles of a capitalist system. It had nothing to do with us. It had very little to do with us. South Africa, ladies and gentlemen, is like a chart that I'm sure you all give your children charts when you're in a shop to play and crayons. And they sit there and they have different pieces of crayon with different colors. That's South Africa. We can change the color, but not the frame. We are like little children sitting in that shop corner, given crayons and a chart. But the frame on the chart cannot change. We get different colors. It can be purple, yellow, or red. And that is what we must change. And for this, the guilty people are those who occupy the three branches of government, because they've become an elite pact that seeks to perpetuate the exclusion of ordinary people. And that's the judiciary, that's the legislature, and that's the executive. I know I get into trouble about saying this because we say judges can't be criticized. It's all rubbish. No one who occupies public power must be protected from criticism. None whatsoever. If Dali Mpofu becomes a judge next year, God forbid, it won't happen. Yeah, you and me, no. We must be able to tell him that he is no God. You are a repository of public power. And there's a whole story when we talk about the judiciary that when you criticize judges, you must give reasons. It means Umam Vemve sitting here must get legal advice, senior counsel, to criticize someone who occupies public power. It's all rubbish. It's something designed to make sure that ordinary people don't scrutinize us for how we abuse judicial, executive, or legislative power. Everyone who occupies those three things must get the wrath from those who gave them that power. And our leaders do this. When I use another Zulu frame, but it's much more crude. It says our leaders, Banya Indoni Nemkiwane. Masithi umuntu ngesiZulunya indoni nemkhwewane. Sisho ukuthi our leaders speak from both sides of their mouths. Literally, they speak from both sides of their mouths, depending on the audience. Our people are told what they want to hear as if they are little children at a preschool who are asking for balloons. And that's what you are. And they will bring food parcels at a particular point. They will give you damages for your brothers and sisters who died in Marikana, but they will take no accountability for it. We live in a country with no conscience. It's led by people with no revolutionary ethics. It's led by people who we can boldly say are spiritually vacuous people. It's individuals who've turned our revolutionary project into their project for personal enrichment. In the legislature, in the executive, in the judiciary, and I say boldly, without fear of contradiction, we have nothing but morally, as I said, and spiritually empty individuals engaged in an elite class pact to perpetuate the continued survival of white domination at the expense of their own people. Ours is a country ruled through an elite class pact that cuts across the three branches of the state. In the end, our people have nowhere to go when any of the branches of the state mistreats them. Where do you go when your entire state has become an elite pet run for the convenience of one man? I say in this country we're reaching a point where there are leaders who will rape a two-year-old child, and our system will condemn the child. Our judges will find the child guilty of getting close to the president or close to a judge. That's where we are with justice. And I've said this over and over. The test for justice is not how we deal with people we like. The test for justice is how we give it to those who need it most, the condemned, the despised, the poor. Bishop Paul Varenne says to us here, right, we have forgotten to be compassionate. There is nothing needed for anyone to be a revolutionary except one thing. One thing. It's not money. It's love for human nature. It's love for those you live with. And as I said, I'm less enthusiastic about our much celebrated new democracy because it seems to me that we could have done so much in 30 years and we don't do it because we've become an appendage to the very system that has kept an African person where he or she is for centuries. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been centuries living in the state you are in. It's been centuries since you buried the first group of Africans that were butchered. It's been decades. None of us thought that the first victims, the first people to be killed by a post-colonial democratic state would be black. None of us thought so. Not because we thought they should have been white, but we did not think that the first victims of this democratic state would be black men and women asking for money. Most of us finish having dinner with Dalimpofu somewhere. They were not asking for much. And so when I say we led by spiritually vacuous people, I want you to understand that the death of these people that I mentioned symbolized much, much deeper problems about our society, about ourselves, and what we think of ourselves. Forget about the white class and what they think of us. We know what they think of us. It's about how do we think, what do we think of ourselves? When leaders see us, what do they see? And when we see the person sitting next to you, what do you see? And if they died, and if they told you tonight they don't have any food to eat, what would you say? And that is what we were creating, a compassionate government. We were electing people who are compassionate, who will make sure that what happened to us for more than 400 years would not happen even for a day. It continues to happen unabated. And so until that ideology of colonialism, that ideology that makes us hate ourselves, that makes us think an African person is less human. And this is not a crime committed by white people. No, we do it ourselves. Go today to any shopping center and watch the black lady treat you and watch how he treats the white lady next to you. It's different. It's because of what we think of ourselves. And until we've gone out of that colonial mindset, it means it was uzithanda. And so I'm touched by this decision that you remember these people. Because for me, no one has symbolized the nature of our new state than the people who died in Marikana. Not because the other deaths were unimportant. Those deaths are important as this one, but this one is important because it took all of us by surprise. And it's a sacrifice those people made and their families made to shine a light into our own consciences about what we think of ourselves and what we think of our people when we see them. Ladies and gentlemen, go around and go to Giani, go to Guamashu, go to Khayelitsha, go everywhere. Go to Soweto here in Alex. Just walk there. And you tell me whether you think those people will get out of that life in the next 200 years if we continue doing the things we are doing. And so last time I suggested what we should do, and not because I'm a nihilist, very responsible senior counsel, I think, but I think we must start all over. It's time to collapse this entire system and start all over. It's time to collapse these three branches of government whose existence is the continued survival of white domination of our people. And I'm not saying you collapse them because I think we should have chaos. I think it's time we go back to the drawing boards and ask our people, do they have an education system that they think will deal with the consequences of colonialism? Do our children have an education system that you can be proud of, that teaches them critical thinking so that they can be leaders one day? If this lady got ill tonight, will be able to access the best health care tonight? That our people during COVID had to share what do you call this thing? The ventilator in a public hospital. Please use it for 15 minutes and give it to Madlamini. Please give it to Mankosi. Is that what we fought for? Now, of course, as I said, when we say these things, we are met with sophisticated words from our comrades in black, green, and gold. They tell us that we do not know the balance of forces. We don't know what they are dealing with. We do know what you're dealing with. You're dealing with your dirty consciences and your assumptions that our people will tolerate this forever. And so for me, when AMCU did what it did, and a lot of people, a lot of us who grew up in the African National Congress condemned some of you. And we did this because, of course, I said to Dali the other week, we grew up in the NC. And I said, Dali, you know, this is how I feel about the revolution in South Africa. I feel like discovering that your mother was a prostitute and you didn't know, and it's just been revealed. I feel that we organized our people and told them about liberation, but what they didn't know that some of us were sleepers dressed in black, green, and gold to deceive them. And it's for that reason that we administer massacres against them. And so, as I said at the beginning, we will be judged by history. And it will judge us two things: what we do and what we tolerate. And the second part is about each one of us. What is it that we are tolerating, and for how long are we tolerating it? Now, of course, I'm not asking you to go out and be chaotic. I'm asking you to look at yourselves and to look at the democratic spaces, if you have that democratic space, and do something about it. But if it doesn't work, you have to make one choice. Well, two choices. You watch the people of God suffer for the next 400 years again. Or you fight and destroy it so that the people of God can know liberation from that day. And if you want the 69 people who died in Sharpeville, the 176 people who died in Soweto, the 35 people who died in Langa, the 29 people who died in Bisho, the 34 people who died in Mankana, the people who died in Phoenix. If you want their deaths to mean something, to turn things around, if you want our people to have an education system that is decolonial in character, that changes the education that we got, that tells us that we are inferior, the education that tells us that when we are leaders, we must please the people who hate us. You just listen to how our leaders speak to our people. Every time they speak, I hear Luwile Grange and Beck Botha and P.W. Botha and John Foster. Take them to a suburb and hear how respectful they are when they speak to races that they think are superior to them. And so our task is to make sure that we support the state that we put in place. And if that state has become part of what kills us, is to remove it. Because freedom does not come from the oppressor. It comes from the oppressed. It will always come from you. You will be the first to break the chains that tie you to the system that kills you. And so if we are to create a society that respects human life, that does not subject our women to low salaries, as I didn't even know that there's still such a pay gap between men and women. I thought we'd gone past that. If we want to make sure that our children, even in the suburbs where we live, because we think we want to protect our little corners where we live, none of us are free until all of us are free. You will live in fear for as long as there are people, millions of them, who have nothing. You will live in fear behind those high walls. You will live in fear in that German sedan because you've allowed others to starve. We will never know peace until each one of us is in peace. We will never know liberation until we free inside and everybody else that we live with is free. And our lives have been turned, and I mean Africans, many of us are lucky because we've been able to get through the system. But generally, our people, 34% of our children are unemployed. And our people live in queues below the poverty line. And if we tolerate it, this idea of a non-racial South Africa in which black and white live together, where color and race are irrelevant, will never happen. Every year, we will fear, what will they do to us? And we call them these people. We call them these people because we've kept them on the margins of our mainstream economy. And the people in Marikana died because of that attitude. And let me just tell you what Nguki says about this attitude. Nguki wa Tiongo characterizes what our leaders have become and what we have become in how we deal with blackness. As you leave this hall, the first person you will see who's white, you're going to smile at him, and the black person, you're going to show your ugly face. It's because we don't respect who we are. He says this. In a lecture he gave in the commemorating Steve Biko, says colonialism tried to control the memory of the colonized, or rather, to borrow from the Caribbean thinker Sylvia Winter, it tried to subject the colonized to its memory, to make the colonized see themselves through the hegemonic memory of the colonized center. Put another way, the colonizing presence tried to mutilate the memory of the colonized. And where that failed, it dismembered it and then tried to remember it to the colonizer's memory, his way of defining the world, including his take on the nature of the relations between the colonizer and the colonized. This relation was primarily economic, for nobody colonizes another for the aesthetic joy of simply doing it. The colonized as a worker, as a peasant, produces for another. And that's what you did. That's what you do daily. You produce for another. And if you demand payment, Marikana will happen. This is, of course, affected through political power. Close quote. And when I said the colonial project does not change. It keeps changing form. And when they think you are too unhappy, it co-opts your leaders to lead the project, to lead your own death, your own colonization. And so we need a complete liberation of our minds first to see blackness as something human, to see ourselves as people who can lead human emancipation. And that requires us, it requires the churches, it requires God, it requires our traditional healers to heal our people of the self-hate they experience. And to heal our fellow white South Africans to come down from their arrogant towers and lack of remorse about what they did. I always say to those white people who can't tolerate the truths we tell, put yourself in our shoes. For 10 days, not 400 years, can you live the way we live for 10 days? Can you live the way my mother lived? Can you live the way my father lived, died of asthma, waking for us, sappy, and could not get to a clinic? How many of you? And all we're asking for is not to take anything away from any citizen. We love everybody. Is that we must live together as equal humans, and none of us must be killed for demanding to be human. And so I've said these things and people say, so what do we do? You know, the reason we ask this question, what must we do? It's because we are cowards. We know exactly what we must do. Each one of us, educated and uneducated, we know what we must do. The reason Dali and I won't do it is because we want to protect our double-storied houses. The reason you won't do it is because you think they will kill you. The reason you won't do it is because the banks will close our accounts. The reason we don't do it is because our kids will be removed from private schools. The day we regard human freedom as our priority, the day we see ourselves as equal humans who require salvation, I know it's a religious term, but that's what we need. The day each one of us, including the sellouts who lead us, the day each one of us regard human life as worth it, the day we know that each individual was made in the image of God and requires protection of those in power, requires protection of our economy, our mineral resources, requires a better education system, does not need to die for demanding to be human, we shall be free. It is at that point that we'll be free. And our leaders huff and puff. They were huffing and puffing yesterday, telling our people things they told them 5 years ago, because they refused to nationalize banks, they refused to give people land without compensation, something they promised, they refused to give our people free hand. Only in this country you can debate for 30 years that human beings require free health care and a free education. If you think education is expensive, try ignorance. It is their ignorance that makes them kill us. It is their ignorance that makes them angry when we tell them the truths we tell them. We don't tell them these truths because we are better. We are human like them. I'm human like each one of them. But most of us, since we're 18, have done nothing else but persuade our people that the struggle for liberation was worth it. I don't know what to say to most of them when I see them now. I don't know what to say to them when they say, "Didn't we tell you that your leaders will sell you out?" And we've sold out not just one country, but the entire continent is subjected to its former colonial powers. And the reason we speak from both sides of the mouth when we talk about Ukraine and Russia, when we talk about multilateral structures, it's because we want to live a double life. We want to please Western countries who colonized us. We also want to please friends who helped us through during liberation, because we don't know what we stand for. It shouldn't be that difficult to live truthfully. You shouldn't have to speak in any diplomatic terms to tell truths as a country to your people and to the world. We shouldn't be told by Biden what to do. We shouldn't be told by Biden which people to hate. And one of the dangers we've reached at this point is that when all of these three arms of the state, the judiciary, the executive, and the legislature, none of them is independent enough to tell the other you are wrong, our people have nowhere to go. And it's at that point that they will see true insurrection. It's when our people can go to no structure of government to seek protection. And we are heading there, you're right. It's gonna happen in one day. And the people will leave and go to the US because they have money, and they will leave us to pick up the pieces when they privatize all state institutions because they want profits, because they are pleasing their companies. They will leave us and go and settle in Canada where their profits have gone. And we'll be left to pick up the pieces, to refurbish Alexandra, to make our people live decently again. And we will call Bishop Veren to pray for us again, but our country will be gone. And it's for that reason that I think the only way we can prevent Marikana from happening again is that we hold our leaders accountable, or else they must ship out. And this belief that elections are what will free you is not true. When people are corrupt, they control how elections happen. They control the results. They control the judiciary. They control parliament. They control cabinet. They control the media and all levers of power in society. And where do you go? And I'm not suggesting that you should be violent, but I'm suggesting that when those spaces are closed, it's not now, I don't know when, you will feel the pinch. When those spaces are closed for our workers to be human, to get benefits from what they suffer for underground and elsewhere, when our young people know that they have no future under this system, and when those institutions of the state can no longer protect you, it is not a crime to seek other means to overthrow a government. It would be a sin to allow a sinful, evil state to destroy generations while you tolerate it, while you watch. The sin would not be turning against that system. The sin is watching it and tolerating it. When our people are condemned for the next 400 years, and as I close, let me go to where I started. These deaths do not happen by accident. They happen because colonialism has taught us to despise ourselves, to hate black lives ourselves, because we do not think we are worth it. Ladies and gentlemen, how many killers during apartheid have we been told about? Many. De Kock, Many of them. None of them. And I'm not suggesting the people I'm going to mention are innocent. I don't know. That this country can watch a woman for 12 months, Busisiwe Mkhwebane is being victimized on TV because she's black. It's something we've not done even to those who killed our people in 1976. And I know we do this because we are saying we are making people account. We've not made a man who said concomitant action must be taken for people to die. We've not asked him to account. Yet he has the nerve to put one black woman to be abused by men every day on TV, colluding with their white masters who handled them under apartheid when we all thought they were comrades. We tolerate it. The reason we tolerate it, we've not put Joe Mamasela there. We've not put Yon de Kock there. Many apartheid killers are at work now, handling the people they used to handle in the 80s that we thought are our leaders. And they kill us because they have become an extension of those people. Therefore, the people of Marikana, the people that I mentioned, are a symbol to us, a shining light to our consciences about what we must do, what we should never tolerate. The next time one black person is killed by this state, I want each one of you to know it's no longer government's problem. It's us. It's what we tolerate. And the next time our people live in poverty in a country that probably could be the richest country in the continent, the next time, which is tonight, an African person goes to bed without food, a child goes to school barefoot, a woman gives birth at the reception of a public hospital, when that happens tonight and tomorrow, it's no longer the fault of our government, because I have given up on them as spiritually vacuous people who've betrayed their own. The problem is us, and that we've decided to tolerate yet again the victimization, the exploitation, and the murder of an African body, of an African person. Because spiritually, we've not turned our lives to look deep inside ourselves and how do we treat black lives. And our leaders must learn from us that black lives matter, that people in Marikana matter, that people who died in Langa matter, that people who died in Sharpeville matter, that people who died in Phoenix matter, and all of this sophisticated language that we hear every day. And our leaders have mastered this thing of speaking for 5 minutes, saying nothing, speaking English, but saying nothing about the plight of our ordinary people. And as I said, I invite you, if you think I'm too critical of this state, I invite those of you like me who live in suburbs, just leave your safe suburb a bit, drive to Soweto, drive to Alex, and if you do have time, drive to our rural areas, and you tell me, those children you will see at the street corners who have nothing to do at 11 o'clock midday will ever change their lives. And if you can tolerate that, there's no hope for you. There's no hope for us. And each one of us, as I said, the challenge we have to remember people in Marikana, Bab Matunjwa, is that I haven't heard AMCU again. I was inspired by AMCU when it started. But I think you hold it as AMCU with all the insults that you get. And as I said it to you, truth-telling is a lonely job. I don't know how many WhatsApps I'll get today to say, comrade, how can you say this? Comrade, it's not right. The movement. Stuff the movement. We must start imagining freedom without the ANC. We must start imagining human emancipation without the traitors that betrayed our people that we call leaders. And I don't know which political party they come from. We must start imagining human salvation simply because we are people of God, not because they are leaders we trust, because we must free ourselves. And that is what I'm asking. We've spent too long attaching human emancipation and human liberation to people who don't care about us. And I ask AMCU, you may not be a massive party. Truth-telling does not need masses. It needs one person. It's to continue to tell people the truth. And as I said at the beginning, quoting Martin Luther King that you started with, if you have nothing you are prepared to die for, you are not fit to live. Thank you.
I am of the view that a round of applause is free, and therefore we can be a bit more generous with it. I don't know about you, I sat there and I even forgot I was program director, because I'm sitting there thinking, I want to make mental notes, I want to remember so many of those points that you gave us so richly and so generously. And I think what stuck out for me is what you said about how we will be remembered. And I put it in my own personal context as a woman, as a professional, as a mother, as a sister, whichever position that you occupy. You said two things will be used to judge an individual. It is what you do and what you tolerate. And I asked myself, I couldn't help but think, what do I tolerate in my space and what can I do to change the situation there? How can I be the change that I want to see in my area? And your words reminded me of a quote that is attributed to a prominent German pastor, Martin Niemöller. And he said, and I quote, "First they came for the socialists, and I did not speak out because I was not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak for me." And so your words really helped me position myself in the various roles that I occupy, and I hope that it did the same for many of us in this room, to say, what is my position? What am I tolerating that might come back to bite me in the future? Ladies and gentlemen, while we process that, because sipanze saphakama sa shaya umzabalazo, yes, umoya. I'm going to ask Unokanya to come and grace us once again with a song, and thereafter we'll receive a message of support and, of course, a vote of thanks. Thank you very much once again, Advocate Ngcela. Another round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Unokanya, it's over to you, sister.
Come with me down Paradise Road. This way, please, I'll carry a load. This you must believe. Take my hand down Paradise Road. Look outside and open your eyes. Cause I believe there are better days before us, and a burning bridge behind the fire smoking. The sky is blazing, there's a woman waiting, weeping, and a young man nearly preaching awful love. Paradise is almost closing down. Come with me down Paradise Road. Look outside and open your eyes. I know, 'cause I believe. Hey, take my hand down Paradise Road. Look outside and open your eyes. I know you must believe. There are better days before us and a burning bridge behind the fire smoking. The sky is blazing. There's a woman waiting weeping and a young man yet beaten. Thank you. I'm going to be saying goodbye to you with a song. It speaks for itself. It says, not yet, Uhuru. Already. Are you good? It's not playing. Why? Okay. I get. Oh, funa ngahambi. No. No, thank you so much, no, Kanya. And indeed, yes, I think it was a ploy from all of us to get you to stay here a little bit longer. I think if we can twist your arm to do that, we'd really appreciate it. Ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to call upon a gentleman, Esimhaije Kayo. Tina, we then say in the scriptures, which they say you must be ready in season and out of season, because you never know. You must lau maulala ulalupete something here just in case bese uthi. So even by accepting the invitation, I'm of the view that maybe you knew Guti, perhaps you might be called upon to say a word or two. The last time we spoke, I think it was divided by a news desk. I was at ENCA, you were the other side. We were looking at some or other political shenanigans going on in this here republic. And he's a political animal through and through, and a well of wisdom and knowledge. And it's a great privilege and an honor to call you. Siyabonga baba, sicela uze baba Audrey Mashiqi. Thank you so much. Can we welcome, please, with a round of applause? Thank you, baba.
I knew that I was going to be asked as an honored gate crasher to speak at this event. What happened was, just after Bishop Verein spoke, I became deaf. Not because of what he said in his prayer. I became deaf because there was pressure in my ears. Because Abba and Yambanabo izihlwele ezi endihamba nazo. ogogo nabomkhulu inkonde nenkondekazi aba abandizala ngokwegazi inkonde nenkondekazi zelilizwe iSouth Africa nenkonde nenkondekazi zelilizwe kazi iAfrika. Nabagogo nomkhulu namhlanje ndizathi nabagogo nomkhulu abalala eMarikana bebulawa zingcelebane zamabhulu in their incarnation as a post-apartheid state. Abagogo nomkhulu umboma apha ababize ngamagama. They were putting pressure on my ears because bafuna utheta. It's not just that they want to be remembered. They want to speak. Bafuna utheta. Bathi ke kum thina asisenayo imizimba. Asisenayo imilomo. Yenyama. Siza kukucela ukuba usithethele. Sithethe ngomlomo wakho. Ngomlomo wakho uthethe amazwi kaThixo uQamata uMvelincangi Ramasedi wabadimbaro. It is through my mouth that they are about to speak. First of all, you look at me and you see a healer. Some will call me Gqirha. Some will call me Isango. Ndiyendibuze okokuba. I usually ask, what does a healer use to heal? And people say healers use umuthi, herbs, and so on. And I say, what is umuthi? And they will give me all sorts of names, Bega Minangetwa, and all sorts of things. Delunina. And the one I've just used now, Mlomo Mnandi. And I say, umuthi, first of all, awukho umuthi odlula ukuthandaza kuQamata. And when I speak about ukuthandaza kuQamata, I'm not just talking about prayer in the sense of any religion. Ukuthandaza uQamata kuQamata Mvelincangi Modimo awukho umuntu odlula lokho. Some of our healers heal us with music. When uNokukhanya sings again, when she comes back on stage, will not only be her but those through whom the gift has descended to her. Her gift of healing is to heal through song. We had another healer just now who healed us through his words. That's his gift. Uskakane, my friend of 40 years, the difference between him and me is that, unlike me, he is not wearing amabhayi nobuhlalo. But he is a healer who heals through the words that descend from God and his ancestors to him, to your ears. Others heal through healing. in how they lead, leadership as healing. And what I want to say to the leaders of AMCU, we may call you president, Bab Matunja. We may call you secretary general. We may call you national treasurer. What you must remember is that you are being called upon to deliver leadership as healing. It is not by accident, Bab Matunja, that you knelt at that kopi, at the bottom of that kopi, and said what you said on that fateful day. You were sent there as isithunywa, a messenger. And therefore, what you must remember, you and those you lead AMCU with, is that leadership is a calling. Leadership does not come through election. Election follows something else, a calling. I am not saying all leaders are true to the calling. I am inviting the leaders of AMCU to be true to the calling of leadership and to provide to us leadership as healing. What happened on that fateful day in August is that our government, this neo-apartheid state, was given a choice. Defend the interests of the working class and mine workers, or defend the interests of mining capital. And theirs was an eloquent answer that came through the sound of bullets as they tore into the bodies of those we remember today. They said, through these bullets that are killing these 34 people, we choose to defend the interests of mining capital and the neo-apartheid state over which we preside. We choose to be allies of coloniality, a coloniality which says, take concomitant action of killing these 34 mine workers in defense of the interests of mining capital and the neo-apartheid state, because they are ontologically and epistemologically inferior. They are not human. It was in their incarnation as an F.W. de Klerk who refused to accept that apartheid was a crime against humanity. There is no way de Klerk could have accepted that apartheid was a crime against humanity, simply because it is not a crime that was perpetrated against those who are human. Therefore, it cannot be a crime against humanity. Our leaders all over the continent and in this country are allies of coloniality, and in this country on that fateful day chose to defend the interests of mining capital and the neo-apartheid state. Chose through that act to ensure that our reality of neo-apartheid continues. This is why we are here. Let me end with how Skakane ended and Ayanda reminded us to remember. We are being called upon to respond to two challenges. What are you prepared to do? And secondly, what are you prepared to tolerate? I will ask this question also to those who preside over this neo-apartheid state and our neo-apartheid reality, I will ask them the same question. What are you prepared to do? And the answer to that is simple. You have shown amply that you are prepared to be allies of coloniality and to be agents of forces that impose a neo-apartheid reality on our people, particularly those who were victims of colonialism and apartheid. What are you prepared to tolerate? We know what they're prepared to tolerate. They are prepared to tolerate the pain and suffering of those who had lived through the pain and suffering of apartheid colonialism. And to you, I ask this question. What are you going to do? I invite you not to answer this question in the presence of others. Answer this question when you are alone. But let me tell you what you must not tolerate. Do not tolerate the lie that is sold to us as constitutional democracy in this country. Do not tolerate the lie of liberal democracy in this country and anywhere in the world. Liberal democracy is a lie that promises much less than it delivers. Do not tolerate the suffering and pain of our people. Do not tolerate the pain and suffering of the children, the mothers, and the wives of Marikana. I will not tell you what to do about it, but do something. Thokoza.
One thing is for certain, the way Singene ngakhona will not be the same as the way we go out. Umqondo wethu has been sharpened. Our perspective has been changed. We have been given, I think food for thought is an understatement. We have been nourished to the point where we are also going to tell abanye to overflow. Ladies and gentlemen, if you may continue to lend me your ears for just a few more minutes, I would like to read a message of support from Brian Ashley, representing Alternative Information and Development Center, the AIDC. He says, and I quote, "Greetings to all the comrades of AMCU. I express my deep regret I cannot be with you today. I wish to especially acknowledge the AMCU members from Marikana who bravely went on strike for much more than a living wage. I also wish to acknowledge the widows and other family members of the martyrs of Marikana. Lastly, but very importantly, I greet the leadership of AMCU, especially the General Secretary, Jeff Mphahlele, Treasurer, Jimmy Gama, and AMCU President, Joseph Matunjwa. Who can ever forget the role that President Matunjwa at Marikana in front of the police Caspers played in defense of the striking workers? This story still has yet to be fully told. It is not said, it is not acknowledged, and completely undervalued the great and sterling work AMCU has played in talking and taking forward the struggle of Mambush and his comrades. It is AMCU which tended to the immediate needs of the families of the martyred. It is AMCU which mobilized progressive lawyers to defend the workers from vilification by the police commissioner and the minister of mining at the time. It was AMCU that rigorously gathered evidence of what really happened on the 16th of August, 2012, and ensured that the Falun Commission
could not be used against the miners. It was AMCU that boldly resisted Lonmin and Anglo Platt's attempt to smash the spirit and resistance of workers through mass retrenchments, and it was AMCU which ultimately won the iconic 12,500 rand wage demand of the rock drillers. The message continues to say, "Dear AMCU comrades, as we commemorate not just the brutal massacre and the collaboration of capital and the state to smash the mass strike of mine workers, which gave us the deadly phrase, concomitant action, demanded by now president of the country, Cyril Ramaphosa, it is necessary to reflect and draw inspiration for the way forward at this time of deep crisis in our country. In truth, we must note that the hundreds of thousands of rock drillers which went on strike in all the major platinum mines of this country were making a statement. Their action was to tell the mine owners, enough is enough. Their heroic actions were a profound statement against the reproduction of a neo-apartheid system where black workers must continue to live and work like slaves without dignity. The rock drillers were drawing attention to the continuation of a migrant labor system where the state refuses to provide decent housing and services to mine workers. Consequently, we have the reproduction of a divided apartheid city, towns and villages. It is an absolute disgrace that more than 10 years after the massacre, Marikana is worse than an Indian slum. But what one sees in Marikana is the reality all over the country. Everywhere across our country, we see collapse and dysfunction. This is the outcome of two processes, namely, one, the extreme budget cuts and privatization of state assets and functions to meet the demands of the foreign investors, white monopoly capitalists, and credit agencies. Two, the drive to create a black capitalist class dependent on the state for tenders and procurement contracts. The outcome has been the outsourcing of municipal and other state functions to incompetent and corrupt corporations and the breeding of a culture of assassination and destruction rather than solidarity and ubuntu. It is this culture that has poisoned politics and the political process in this country. It has created a vacuum politically where integrity, honesty, sacrifice, and service have been replaced by opportunism. Just look at all the political parties who seek to profit from Marikana by paying lip service and contributing nothing to the lives of workers and mining communities. In the memory of our martyrs, Mambush, and his compatriots, AMCU needs to give great consideration to how this vacuum will be filled. AMCU needs to be at the forefront of leading a campaign for a living wage and decent work for all. Mass unemployment is the source of all the social problems we are currently experiencing. The social fabric in the working class communities is in collapse. Let me quote from an article in Monday's Daily Maverick on the barbaric conditions that the poor in this country face. Open quote. A debt collector looking for repayment of a loan found the bodies of a Butterworth woman and three children at their home on Sunday morning. It is understood that the woman poisoned her small children by mixing the last food in the house with rat poison. Her teenage daughter died after she was stabbed in the throat. The mother then hanged herself. Family members said the woman was deeply in debt and the family had been starving for weeks, close quote. AMCU, as one of the most, if not the most important trade union in this country, cannot stand by and watch what is happening to your class. AMCU must give leadership in the cry of the excluded and in the fight
against austerity and privatization. It must unite with like-minded allies in the labor and social movement to build a huge and powerful force that can revolutionize, transform, and build the society which was promised in our struggle for liberation. Let us never forget, an injury to one is an injury to all. These are the words of Brian Ashley, sent on the 10th of August, and we agree. Thanks. Thank you very much. With that, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to ask that we give Vunuku Khanya another opportunity to grace us with her healing presence, and thereafter we'll receive a vote of thanks. My thank you to you for your time and attention.
Kapela ni lumgane Yes, into city more. Yes, into Sagota. Yes, into Sagota. Yes, into Sagota. Hi, no tattoo. Hi, no tattoo. Hi, no tattoo. Thank you.
Oh, nee, pay. But I we want more hand because after the vote of thanks, okay, you're missing a flight.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And
yes.
Everyone, I owe you.
Yeah.
I can sing now. I'll do another song.
Yes. Yes, please. By popular demand. By popular demand.
All right. Okay, basalungisa la, bayalungisa. Are we good? 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 Okay, we are good. Yelele. How yelele. There's music in the air. It make your sorrow go. Let the music take you there. Far from the world you know. Someday you'll come to make a song. I'll show you a way. Your heart can come along. You everything well made for love. As good as a song, get a man, sit again, look for love in the music, lost in the melody. Find love, sip in the city. In the music, lost in the melody. Oh, you find love. I got city again. Tata, a city. Ah, la, la. Yeah, boy. I'll have a baby. Oh, him, yeah, yeah, oh yeah, yeah. Oh, I want my baby. Oh, him, him, him.
I think we can all agree her debt has been paid in full. Siyabonga kakhulu. And thank you for your time. I know that we are fast approaching the end of the official proceedings. Lunch is waiting for us, but we cannot possibly close without getting a vote of thanks from a gentleman I also met many, many moons ago, and it was very robust conversation here too, as a journalist, but I think it was important because, as the advocate has said, you cannot have people who are out of bounds in terms of questioning and challenging, and he opened himself willingly to be criticized and made himself vulnerable to tough questions at a very, very difficult time, and that for me is the true sign of leadership. He did not duck, he did not dive, he did not run, he did not shift blame. He stood forward and he said, ask me anything. And that conversation, I didn't even want to look back on. But I appreciate that in our maturity collectively and our willingness to work together to build a better South Africa, we indeed said asebenze. So I'm going to ask, please, President Joseph Matunjwa to come to the stage.
Ninga magwala wengwa sato. Wow, yene soto wa wanda we. Wow, yene soto wa wanda wengwa sato. Walo tubula kunze mnyama we. Walo tubula kunze mnyama wengwa sato. Wow, yene soto wa wanda we. Wow, yene soto wa wanda wengwa sato. Walo tubula kunze mnyama we. Walo tubula kunze mnyama wengwa sato. Wow, yene soto wa wanda we. Wow, yene soto wa wanda wengwa sato. Walo tubula kunze mnyama. Walo tubula kunze mnyama wengwa sato. Wow, yene soto wa wanda we. Wow, yene soto wa wanda wengwa sato. Walo tubula kunze mnyama we. Walo tubula kunze mnyama wengwa sato. Wow, yene soto wa wanda we. Wow, yene soto wa wanda wengwa sato. Walo tubula kunze mnyama we. Walo tubula kunze mnyama we. Wele sato bole sapa.
Oh, siyabulela, siyabulela, inkosi, inkosi, inkosi. Bendithi Comrade Dali uzongena phaya. Jesu bazomceba. Ngempela siyabulela, kakhulukazi sibulela uThixo osiphile ithuba. Baninzi bebafuna ukuvuka ekseni kodwa bavukanga kufanele sikuthathe lokho siku sikubonge kakhulu kubaba uNkulunkulu sibonge kakhulu ithuba lokuthi nize nizo zamisa umcimbi omkhulu kangaka akusilula ukungisusa ezindaweni zenu nizo khuluma ezidangalaleni ngoba imsebenzi mininzi kodwa ke nithathe ithuba ukuba nize nizo thetha apha kakhulukazi sibonge kakhulu omama okuyibona esize ngabo kakhulu siyazi ukuthi uma senza lemsebenzi uvuka kabusha amanxeba uvuka kabusha futhi ininjunju kodwa ke uma singakwenzi lokho sizolibala bomama nelizwe lizolibala nokhulumento uzolibala so lokho esikwenzayo asikwenzi ngoba sifuna ukubukisa okanye sifuna ukubuka yizwe kodwa senzela ukuthi kungabi khona ukukhohlwa ngoba isitha somuntu ukukhohlwa so njengoba sikwenza lokho njengoba ubaba uObri ekhulumile ngike ngathetha nomunye umama uma ethe ngathi kuzoba nzima ukuthi beze apha ndathi impendulo yami kuye noma ningaphumeleli mama kodwa imimoya yabo otata nabobhuti izawuba khona apha sihle na yile nto ebeyisho ukuthi asenzeli kutheni kodwa nabalalayo so siyabonga kakhulu kwizindwendwe ngime phambi kwenu really you really appreciate the time that you spend with us and also to allow yourself in your busy schedule to set aside this time really we appreciate it is not because bekungekho abanye abantu but I think the hand of God pointed on you ukuthi please sicela uzozamazisa lo msebenzi sibonge kakhulu obesiphethele uhlelo udadewethu laphayana usis Ayanda ya ukhulumile hey ya babebuza ngalezo sikhathi you were asking questions and not just questions and those want as questions can make you or can break you and ingayishintsha narrative yonke iphonsele kuwamanzi angena endlini ukuthi yes remember the state tried to make sure that the blame of the massacre is channeled to Joseph Matunjwa so the whole commission I still say today without any hesitation that it was a means and a process to put me in jail and to destroy AMCO that was not about the truth because it became a commission of omission because still today the culprits are still enjoying the highest office in the land and the others are being deployed to be ambassadors in the world so therefore the commission was not hence when I call for the commission advocacy as I said the commission maybe should be led by ILO even though it's part of the system after the Second World War all those apparatus are working for the one system but I thought they might be focused and try to dig the truth so it's not that the South African government or led by the African National Congress called for the commission I called for the commission secondly who defined Marikana as a massacre it was myself the first journalist who phoned me just after the massacre just behind the copy was the then Deborah Pata is it yes that was the first person who called me said Joseph are you in the copy I said I'm just behind the copy workers are being massacred I said yes not massacred has been killed So what an incident. I said, not an incident, that's a massacre. He said, no, you can't describe that as a massacre. I said, what's the difference between this one and Sharpeville? Then it's when the great massacre came in. So you remember after the workers were killed, the state said people must report back to work. And we defined, we said, we are not going to go to work. And I really thank all people who really make sure that the justice itself even though monetary yes but accountability is not so I really thank every structures and every person who came here today and make this day so possible without you MC maybe ngabe silahlekile endleleni and without
you a comrade, advocate, future president or chief justice of the country. Sizokubeka thina ukuthi chief justice of the country. And Larry Davis, attorney, bishop, for the wise word, and everyone present, and Prof, thank you very much. I hope you'll join us at Marikana on the 16th of August, a copy. And thank everyone present here in the Koko. We really thank you. Kakhulu siyathokoza. But above all, just a few reflections in my closing remarks. You know, you spoke about tolerance. Our tolerance is too high. It's very high. And as long the tolerance is high, there will be no leadership that is born. Leadership is born once the tolerance is low. Once it's finished, then you see the leadership comes up. And secondly, that I want to emphasize in my closing, vote of thanks. I think we South Africans, we have to blame ourselves moving forward, as Advocate was saying. Because every person who stands before us is a leader. Let me tell you, politicians are not leaders. If you can't differentiate that one, we'll be back to square one. Politicians, they are not leaders. And even they are leaders, they are not true leaders. Politicians are politicians. If you can ask any politician what is his interest is, votes, term of office. That is what politicians are all about. It's not about you. That's why every time, as Advocate was saying, after 5 years, we'll come and tell you the same thing. Ever and ever again, because they are not leaders, they are politicians. Until we realize that the person who stands before you calls himself a politician is not a leader. A politician does not care about your children tomorrow, about the future. It's like a president and a statesman. These are the two different things. A statesman is concerned about the future of the next generation, how he planned. But the state president is concerned about the term of office. That's it. He doesn't care what should your children look like in the next 10 years. The country, the economy. No, it's not. When people are talking about fees must fall, I kept on saying, leave fees must fall, curriculum must fall. That is where the problem is. The issue of fees must fall, it was not a starter to me. I kept on saying the education system of this country is not good. But unfortunately, you know, if Awuyi Evets, Awuyi UJ, no one will listen to you. Your narrative will never be taken until is Mr. Matunjwa from which university? Unfortunately, I'm coming from the University of Wisdom. I've never been to this other university. And furthermore, for my vote of thanks, when AMCO was formed, it was a huge challenge to me. I made so many excuses, as a nation, we keep on making excuses. You know, when you read the book of Genesis chapter 4, Exodus chapter 4, yes, I'm correct. When Moses was called, he had so many excuses. God, I cannot speak. I'm a starter. And until God said, but who made you human being? Who made your mouth? It's not me. So until such time, Nathi, as South Africans, siyeke ukubeka ama excuses and take initiative. Abalidayo bathi, uthini uMoses makafika kuFarao uthi, let my people go. So Nathi kulama khamandela, ufaneke siraise aboMoses abazothi, let our people go. Until such time. So, loko kubalulekile ukuthi sizazi. And lastly, in my vote of thanks, it comes from the same book of Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. There is a huge contradiction that people are making, or they deliberately ignore when they read this verse 26. God said, let's make a man on our own image and have dominion over creatures. There is no human being.
akekho umuntu owadalela ukulida omunye umuntu because we are all God's image. That's a problem that we have. That's why people, they are talking down on us because they see us as creatures, them as leaders. Until we take ourselves serious, that if you speak to us, president, or whoever is in the government, we are talking to other fellow leaders. We are not followers. So we reduced ourselves to be followers. That's the reason these governments and these officials are so arrogant, because we reduce ourselves to be followers. Politicians, the same. When they talk to us, they talk us down because we forget that we are God's image. We are not made to be ruled, to be controlled by anyone. Say amen. Lastly, image and dominion. That's why people, they cannot be able to hold or to handle power, because they don't have image. Image is a character. So if you don't have the character of God, then you have dominion. It's a disaster. So the people, they run to have dominion, to have power, without having the character of God. But once you have the character of God and dominion, because you respect the fellow human being. I thank you very much. May Almighty God bless you. Bo mama siyobanani, akusilula kunzima. Ushilo ubaba ukuthi uma uyilida ukhuluma iqiniso uba wedwa. Wathi ubaba uDumisa Nsebenza in one of the meetings nama comrade, wathi mtanga mathunzi uza kusolwa, they will criticize you, they will blame you for everything. Indoda yohluleka ukumithisa unkosikazi wayo, iblame wena. Imvula izongabingani elalini, kublame wena mathunjwa, ungekho lapha. So ma uyi leader, you must always expect ukuthi abantu, they will blame you and criticize you for whatever things that we do. Ma uzama ukwenza kuthiwa ukushaywa edonsayo, ngithi bathi imoto emile izinja ziyayichamela, kodwa ehambayo ziyayikhonkotha. Thina siyilezo-ke zihlale zikhonkotha ngoba siyahamba. So siya eMarikana ngezi-16 August. Masiyaphaya siyobhongela emswaneni, siyokhumbula abafowethu nodada bethu. We are not just going there to grandstand. We are just going to say, sisesenani, noma kunzima kangakanani. Kodwa remember, you are not a follower. You are a leader. Don't allow a person to look down on you and talk down on you. God has created us all in his own character and image, not in other one's image. So let us not, let's not confuse between a politician and a leader. I'm still telling you, politicians are not leaders, and they will never be leaders. That's it. May Almighty God bless you. Must I give it back to you? Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Ngesilungu bathi, heavy is the head that wears the crown. So when you are in a leadership position, you can expect all those zivungu vungu, the vicissitudes of life, to come your way. We have come to the end of our proceedings. We began with a word of prayer. It's only fitting that we end with a word of prayer. I'm going to ask, please, Deputy President Wetu, Mr. Phuthuma Manyathi, to give us our closing prayer, please, sir.
Ngizocela siphakame sithule iminqwazi, abanelungelo lokuyithwala bayithwale. Masivale namehlo. Heavenly Father, your grace is sufficient. Umusa wakho usanele sonke. When we started, we invited you here. We are now about to close the session. Please be with us. Please be with us as we prepare for the 16th August. We thank you once again for putting us on the wake-up list. We thank you for giving us another day, for protecting us on the way as we come here. You had a specific purpose for us to be here so that you can speak to us through the various speakers, through the music, through all the encouragements that we get from our friends and supporters. We ask all these things, Christ. Please help us that whatever was said here, you open our hearts, our minds, and our souls to deal with our insecurities. Help us to see injustice and does not tolerate it in any way or form. We ask you to protect our members both on surface and underground, our families, wherever they are. We pray for those that cannot find employment to be with them and give them hope and encouragement that one day things gonna be all right. We ask you to be with us on our way back to our different places, to our different commitment throughout the day. And we ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Lastly, we pray for the food we're just about to receive and the hand that prepares it. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen.